Now we are going to talk about embedding entire graphs. So rather than embedding individual nodes, we are going to talk about how do you embed or find an embedding for an entire graph. And the method we are going to talk about is based on anonymous random walks. So we are going to continue the theme of random walks, but these random walks will be anonymous. So let me explain, right? The goal now is to embed a subgraph or an entire graph into the embedding space Z. You may want to do this because you may want to do, for example, molecule classification to predict which molecules are toxic versus which are non-toxic. Or you want to do some kind of graph anomaly detection and you want to do this in the embedding space. So the goal is to embed an entire graph, or you can think of it also as embedding a subset of the nodes in the graph. So first idea that is very simple and people have tried. So the idea is that you run standard node embedding technique like we already discussed in terms of node2vec or deepwalk, and then just sum up or average node embeddings either in the entire graph or in the subgraph, right? So the idea is to say the embedding of the graph is simply a sum of the embeddings of the nodes in that graph. And for example, this method was used in 2016 to classify molecules based on their graph structure, and it was very, very successful. So even though simplistic, works quite well in practice. An improvement over this initial idea of averaging node embeddings is to introduce a virtual node to represent an entire graph or a subgraph, and then run a standard graph embedding or node embedding technique, and then think of this virtual node as the embedding for the graph. So let me explain. Here is the idea, right? I will create this virtual node. I will connect it to the set of nodes I want to embed. Now I can run node2vec on this graph to determine the embedding of this virtual node. And now the embedding of the let's say set of nodes S is simply the embedding of this virtual node in the embedding space as computed by deepwalk or node2vec. And of course, if I'd want to embed the entire graph, then this virtual node would connect to all other nodes in the network. I'd run deepwalk or node2vec over this, determine the embedding of the virtual node, and represent the embedding of the entire graph as the embedding of the red node. So that's idea number two. Now, for idea number three, we are going to define this notion of anonymous walks. And the way we will think of this is that states in the anonymous walk correspond to the indexes of the first time when a given node was visited on the walk. So for example, here is a graph, a small subpart of the graph of interest. Then here are a few random walks on this graph. For example, from A we go to B, C, B, and C. Or another random walk starts at C, goes to D, goes to B, goes to D and back to B. But then we are not going to represent the random walk as a sequence of nodes it visits, but a sequence of times when node was first visited. So for example, these two random walks, 1 and 2 here, get the same representation. It is 1 because A was visited at step 1, then it's 2 because B was visited at step 2, then it's 3 because node C was visited at step 3, then we visited B again, but B was already visited, so it doesn't get a new index, but it gets value 2. And then we went back to C, so again we have number 3. And then this other random walk that started at C went to D, B, D, B, gets actually the same sequence, right? C gets 1, D gets 2, B gets 3, then we go back to D, so it's again 2, and then we go to B and it's again 3. And then, for example, this other random walk now has a different anonymous representation because we go from A to B to A to B to D, right? So it's 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, because at time 3, or node D was visited as the third node in the graph. So these anonymous walks, they are agnostic to the identity of the nodes visited. That's why they are called anonymous. And this means that random walks that have visited different nodes, but kind of in the same order, get the same anonymous walk representation. Now, You may wonder how does the number of walks increase with the length? The number of possible anonymous walks increases exponentially. Here's the graphic. For example, there are 5 anonymous walks of length 3. You know, here they are. You can basically stay at the same node 3 times. You can stay 2 times at the same node and then navigate to the second node. You can go from first node to the second, back to the first. You can go from first to the second, stay at the second, or you navigate from node 1 to node 2 to node 3. And these are the 5 possible anonymous walks of length 3. And then, you know, of length 4, it would be more, there would be 15, and of length 12, there would be, I don't know, 4 million, as it shows here. So how are we going now to embed a graph? One idea is to simply simulate anonymous walks of length L and record their counts, and then represent the graph as a probability distribution over these walks. So, for example, if I pick anonymous walks of length 3, then we can represent a graph as a 5-dimensional vector, because there are 5 different anonymous walks of length 3, as I explained earlier, where you know, the embedding of the graph, the ith coordinate of that embedding is simply the probability that the probability or the fraction of times anonymous walk of type I has occurred in the graph G. So now this would basically mean that we are embedding a graph as a 5-dimensional representation. Now, if you want higher number of dimensions, you increase the length of the anonymous walk. That's the idea for the anonymous walks and how you can basically count them and then have a probability distribution over the fraction of times each anonymous walk occurs on your graph. You set the dimensionality of the representation by basically setting the length of the anonymous walk, right? Now, of course, the question also becomes how many random walks do you need? And there is very nice mathematical formula that tells you how many anonymous walks you want to sample, such that your estimates in their frequency or their probabilities of occurrence are accurate. And you can quantify accuracy by 2 parameters, epsilon and delta, where basically we say we want the distribution of these probabilities of anonymous walks to have error of no more than epsilon with probability less than delta. You can plug in these 2 numbers into the following equation, and that will tell you the number of anonymous walks you may need to sample. So for example, if you consider anonymous walks of length 7, there is 877 of them. If you set epsilon to 0.1 and delta to 0.01, then you would need to sample about 120,000 random walks that you can estimate this probability distribution over these 877 different anonymous walks. So that's the idea in terms of anonymous walks. And we can further enhance this idea to actually learn embeddings of the walks themselves. So let me explain how we can do this. So rather than simply representing each walk by the fraction of times it occurs, we can learn an embedding z sub I of anonymous walk wi. And then we can learn also a graph embedding z sub g together with the anonymous walk embeddings. So this means we are going to learn the number of embeddings we are going to learn will be the number of anonymous walks plus 1, because we are learning an embedding for every anonymous walk plus the embedding for the graph. Right? So again, how are we going to learn these embeddings of graph and the anonymous walks? We do this in a very similar way to what we did for deep walk or node to walk. We want to embed walks so that walks adjacent to it can be predicted. So let me explain the idea. So the idea is that, again, we will have this vector G that describes the graph. We are going to have the, and this will be the embedding of the entire graph we are going to learn. Let's say we start from some node 1 and we sample anonymous random walks from it. So then the idea is to learn to predict walks that co-occur in some delta window size around as we are sampling these random walks from a given node. So the idea is that the objective function is. We want to go over this window size delta, where this WT are random, are anonymous random walks that all start at a starting node 1, and Z sub G is the embedding of the graph. And now we basically sum this objective over all starting nodes in the graph. So the idea is that we will run capital T different random walks from each node U of length L. So now our notion of neighborhood is not a set of nodes, but it's a set of anonymous random walks, here labeled by W. And then we want to learn to predict walks that co-occur in a window of size delta. So the idea is that we want to estimate embedding Z sub I on anonymous walk WI, and then maximize this given objective, where basically we go over all the random walks that we run from the given node. This is a sequence of random walks or anonymous walks that occurred. Our goal is to find the embedding of the graph as well as the embeddings of the anonymous walks so that we can predict what is the next anonymous walk, what is the identity of the next anonymous walk that is going to occur in this sampling of anonymous walks. So essentially, this is the same objective function as we used in node2vec or deepwalk, but the difference is the following, is that when we are defining this notion of neighborhood, we don't define neighborhood over the nodes that are visited, but we define it over the anonymous walks that occur starting from node U. So here, W is an entire anonymous walk. It's an ID of an anonymous walk. If you want more details and read more, there is a paper linked down here that you can read for further details. But the idea here is, right, that now that we have learned both the embedding of the node as well as the embedding of the walks, as we learn the embedding of the graph, we can use this Z sub G as a descriptor of the graph, and we can use it in downstream prediction task. Right? So to summarize, we obtain the graph embedding Z sub G, which is learnable after this optimization. And then we can use Z sub G to make predictions, for example, for graph classification. We can use the dot product the same way as we were using so far, or we could use a neural network that takes Z sub G as an input into a classifier and tries to predict some label of this graph G. Both options are feasible in this case. So in this part of the lecture, we discussed three ideas about how to embed entire graphs. First was simply average or sum up embeddings of the nodes in the graph, where the embeddings of the nodes are computed by deepwalk or node2vec. The second idea was to create a supernode that spans the subgraph of interest and that embed that supernode. And then the idea number three was to use this notion of anonymous walk embeddings, where we sample anonymous walks to represent graph as a fraction of times each anonymous walk occurs. So that's one idea. And the second, more complex idea was to embed anonymous walks and then either, for example, concatenate their embeddings or use this Z sub G to define the notion of the embedding of the entire graph. What we are going to consider in the future is also more different approaches to graph embeddings. And in particular, many times graphs tend to have this type of community or cluster structure. So it becomes a good question, how do we hierarchically aggregate the network to obtain the embedding of the entire graph? And later in lecture 8, I'm going to discuss such an approach that uses graph neural networks to be able to do this. So towards the end of the lecture, the next question is, you know, how do we use these embeddings ZI of the node, for example? You can use them, for example, to cluster the points. Basically, you take the graph, compute the embeddings, and then run a clustering algorithm over the embeddings, for example, to do community detection or any kind of social role identification. You can use these embeddings for node classification, simply predict the label of node I based off its embedding Z. And you can also use them for link prediction, where basically you can take nodes I and J and you can concatenate their embeddings, and then based on the concatenation, you can make a prediction. When you are combining these node embeddings, you have several options. As I said, one is simply concatenating them. Another option would be to combine them by doing per coordinate product. This is nice for undirected graphs because this operation is commutative. You can also sum or average them, another commutative operation, meaning that, you know, probability of link from I to J is the same as from J to I. Or you could measure some kind of L2 distance and then make a prediction based on these kind of different aggregations of the two embeddings. If you want, make predictions in directed graphs, then concatenation is nice because you are able to output a different probability depending on, you know, is it from I to J or from J to I. For graph classification, node embedding can be computed via aggregating node embeddings or through anonymous walks or through this anonymous walk embedding plus the graph embedding approach that we have discussed. So to summarize, today we discussed graph representation learning as a way to learn node and graph embeddings independent of downstream prediction tasks and without any manual feature engineering. We discussed this encoder-decoder framework, where encoder is simply an embedding lookup and decoder predicts the score or network-based similarity based on the embeddings of the nodes. We defined a notion of node similarity based on the random walks. We discussed two methods, deep walk and node-to-vec, that use the same optimization problem, the same negative sampling approach, but deep walk uses a very simple random walk, basically a first-order random walk, while node-to-vec uses a second-order random walk that can, where you can kind of fine-tune the way the network is explored. And then we also discussed extensions to graph embeddings, which means that we can simply aggregate node embeddings. And we also talked about anonymous random walks, where the anonymous random walk represents the walk not by the identities of the nodes, but by the time or by the index at what time a given node was first visited. So this is a set of approaches I wanted to discuss today, and thank you very much for watching and attending the lecture.